Good evening, everybody. It's really nice to be here, and it's really great to see some familiar faces. I should say right at the outset that I'm going to say very few things that are actually original, and that many of the people with whom I collaborate the most fondly are actually in this room. So I'll try to give credit where credit is due, but I think our field is as strong as it is because we all come together to collaborate, and more on that as we go through. The other first thing I want to say is welcome to anybody that might be new to the field. I'm fond of saying that every one of my gray hairs came from some sort of an evaluation or treatment experience that I did. I've been doing this for 30 years now, and I came into the field. It's always so fascinating to find out how people come to do this kind of work, and how once we are in, I'm not convinced that any of us ever really leave. We take the work really seriously, the work has value, and I think retiring from our field can be something of a challenge. My story is actually really boring, and I needed a job, and I took a job where I would work with people who had experienced sexual violence, and it seemed like the right thing to do, but over time, it got really frustrating dealing with people who had been hurt. And sooner or later, there's a temptation to go upstream from this experience and to try to prevent sexual crimes by working with the people who have actually caused sexual harm. So if we don't do a lot of research and treatment to figure out who are these people that are causing this harm, then I don't see how we can ever really truly say that we're preventing sexual violence. However, it can be a little bit like encountering this Northern Maine street gang, that you're walking along the road of life, and the next thing you know, you are encountering these bears. And you ask yourself things like, are they mad? Are they bad? Are they mentally ill? Are they personality disordered? And sometimes the answer is all of the above, and sometimes it's none of the above. And that is the endless fascination of this work. As Elizabeth mentioned, this is just a photograph from the women's movement of the 1960s. I was born in 1960. I think my mother might be in this photograph. She certainly tried to raise me right. And for the first time, even though there's references to sexual crimes in the Bible and in the traditions of various indigenous cultures, it seems to me it was the first time that the problem of sexual abuse actually made it onto the main stage of national dialogue. And for the first time, people, talk show hosts and celebrities, were talking about their own experiences of victimization. And I know that in the mid-1970s, there was a book that actually argued that in an age where we have all sort of male-dominated patriarchal society, there could be no such thing as truly consensual sex. I thought that was taking it maybe a little bit far, but I do take the point that there's a lot of dynamics involved in abuse that we should be studying. So also, as others have already mentioned, what do we know about human beings? People who've been hurt come together and talk about what's bothering them. We all join up. We all connect at the places where we've been hurt or wounded in one way or another. And in our field, I'm not sure it's any different. This is a photograph of one of the very first ATSA conferences. People in our field trying to get together to figure out what can we do to properly assess and treat people who have abused. I see some smiling faces as we recognize some of our sort of collective ancestors. So one of the things that we did learn in those days is that there's many motivations for sex crimes. When I came into the field, people talked about sex offenders as if they were some sort of discrete form of humankind, and came to find out it's actually anything but. That there's all sorts of motivations for sex crimes. The first of them is sexual. Somebody has a sexual interest in something that, if they act on it, is going to be illegal or abusive, period, end of story. And then, as we know, there's many people who abuse as a result of non-sexual needs or desires. Just to be blunt about it, some people can be mean. They're not maybe mean all the time, but they're mean on that day, or they're drunk, or they're angry, or they're uncaring and select somebody of convenience to them. Maybe it's all of the above. But it's not the case that everybody who abuses sexually abuses out of sexual motivations. And James Cantor will be talking about that some more in just a moment. And then there was this fellow here, Robert Martinson, who came along in 1974. He wrote an article that made him a very, very famous man. And if you do a Google search on him, you can still find interviews that he did for People magazine in the mid-1970s. He didn't really check his numbers all that well, and he published this article that said, basically, criminal justice rehabilitation programs just don't seem to be bearing any fruit. And the evidence to the contrary came out the next year, in 1975, and by 1979, he wrote an article that basically said, I was wrong. And he died the following winter, basically disgraced. And I mention him because in many ways his ghost is still in this room. With all of our mythology that people can't change or that treatment doesn't work, et cetera, et cetera. There's many controversies in the field, of course, but we have to be careful how we listen to stuff that we hear in the media about whether or not our efforts are going to be successful. By the time the 1980s rolled around, there were some influential studies. Some of you who rode with these fellows might recognize them as the Hell's Angels from the 1960s. I just like putting the picture in. But we started finding out, both in practice and in research, that before people get caught for sex crimes, they tend to have done it quite a bit in their past. And they weren't caught, leading us to think, well, maybe then they're all at high risk and destined to this lifetime of havoc and destruction. Maybe we need to make treatment even more strong, harsh, confrontational, or what have you. And the simple fact is, there is a very big difference between somebody who comes to the attention of the legal system and somebody who doesn't. And that I think the most recent numbers I saw were that 95% of people arrested for a sex crime, it's their first and only time being arrested for a sex crime. Obviously, that leaves 5% of people who we have to take very, very seriously. But we began to realize not all sex offenders are equally dangerous. And that really it would take a vast amount of research evidence to demonstrate otherwise. And so the first actuarial measure to figure out or to classify sex offenders according to their dangerousness really came out around 1997. Promising starts before then, but 1997 is within living memory for most of us. So much has changed, but the word isn't necessarily getting out as well as it should. And then there's all the controversies around treatment. The first review of treatment studies wasn't particularly optimistic and led many of us to a kind of therapeutic nihilism, or shall we say, that we started to panic, or at least we weren't as optimistic as maybe we should have been. And subsequent studies came along saying, people who complete treatment programs really do seem to reoffend at lower rates. And then other studies came along to back this up a little bit. And then along came one analysis that I think is really important. It found that that the most effective programs seem to dole out the most intensive services to those who pose the greatest risk. There are also the programs that specifically target scientifically proven treatment goals. And finally, there are also the programs that actually work very hard to make sure that the services they're providing are actually understood and meaningful to the clients in treatment, something that is all too easy to overlook. We've also learned that people who actually successfully complete their treatment goals really do seem to reoffend at lower rates, even if we can't show it in some of our highest quality studies. Time is short here today, but if I were to put it all together, I would borrow from the work of my friend Gwenda Willis, as well as Doug Bauer, and say that the safest sex offender is somebody who's stable, somebody who's occupied with a job or education, has supportive people in his or her life to whom he's accountable, has some kind of plan for the future, and has everything to lose by repeating this behavior. So that's just a brief overview. Thanks for your time.
Hi, I'm James Cantor. I'm a psychologist and sexual behavior scientist at the University of Toronto, and I'm editor-in-chief of SageArt, Sexual Abuse, a Journal of Research and Treatment. And in the next 10 minutes, I'm going to teach you brain anatomy. Really, it's very strange to be somebody who studies the brain and studies sex at the same time because we know so little of it. But I get the same set of questions over and over and over again. I just call them the big questions. We don't actually, of course, have the time to really do any kind of brain anatomy, but I'll show you the kind of evidence that my team and other teams have been producing that have shown us that pedophilia actually is a phenomenon of the brain. There has been for many, many years the belief, and it's only been a belief, we call it the abused abuser hypothesis, that being the victim of abuse causes somebody to be an abuser in adulthood. Although that seems obvious to many of us, if we think about it for a second, there are some important clues that that theory doesn't explain. Almost all of the abusers are male. The majority of the victims are female. If this were just a like-makes-like phenomenon, we should see more equal numbers, but we don't. This is one of the most unequal sex ratios known to all of behavioral science. So there's something missing in the idea of like-makes-like and the abused-abuser hypothesis. Now, the idea that this is in the... that one? Excellent. The idea that that pedophilia is in the brain actually is a very old idea. It goes back to the 1800s. Only Freud published after that, and he was much more popular because he wrote in English. The other researchers at the time wrote largely in Latin because they thought all the sex discussion would be too intense for the public, so they didn't want the uneducated reading, so they wrote in Latin and German, so nobody read it, even though it turned out in the long term to be the correct theory. These are the big questions, and I'll get back to them at the end. I want to make a very, very big distinction between these two terms, which are unfortunately still treated as synonyms. They're not. Pedophilia is not the same as child molestation. Even in the media, they're treated as synonyms. They're different things. Pedophilia is the actual sexual interest, sexual preference, sexual arousal in response to children. Child molestation is the actual behavior. They're, of course, very strongly overlapping. In the great majority, in many of the cases, pedophilia is what's motivating the child molestation, but there are pedophiles, people who are sexually interested in children and never act on it. In fact, they're beginning to form support groups that, you know, doc, I got a problem, but they often feel like they can't talk to their own doctors because of mandatory reporting requirements. If a father comes in, tells his physician, psychologist, psychiatrist that he's attracted to children, in very many circumstances and in very many jurisdictions, the care provider is required to report that case to the authorities. Now, of course, therefore, the pedophile himself knows that, so he doesn't go in and report it to begin with. So all we've done with mandatory reporting laws is that instead of having pedophiles out in society getting support, we have pedophiles out in society receiving no support or treatment. There, feel safer. We have passed laws that are making things worse, not better, out of hysteria. Okay, now this is some of the evidence that started my team, and there are two other teams in the world working on the role of the brain in pedophilia. Again, there's my team in Canada and two other teams in Germany. Where are the Americans? Now, one of the first clues that we had, this is what we call a meta-analysis. It was a study of studies. And in studies, over and over again, we found a relatively subtle effect, but a very replicated and predictable effect. Basic IQ tests, a standard part of most assessments. The IQs of people who commit sexual offenses against children and people who are genuinely pedophilic, both, have lower IQs than people who don't. To a neuroscientist, IQ is kind of like a blood pressure. It's just a basic idea of health in the brain. So this was one of the first ideas that something in the brain was different among pedophiles than non-pedophiles. We continued with the same kind of research. Maybe the dumb pedophiles are more likely to get caught. Turned out we got the same result with memory tests. Okay, well, memory is kind of related to IQ. Maybe it's something specific to the memory test. We found it both in verbal memory and in nonverbal memory. We found it in the propensity to get involved in accidents that were severe enough, head injuries that were severe enough to cause unconsciousness, but only when they happened before age 13 and not after. There was no difference with older or adult head injuries. Now, of course, starting in the 1970s, people stopped failing grades and said we assigned people to special education programs. But if you add them, somewhere around two-thirds of pedophiles, actual pedophiles, people who were sexually interested in children, failed a grade or were referred to special education programs. The base rate, the number of people in most of society, that's about 3%. Something is going on, and important with this, this was before any offense happened. The head injuries were also before anything in the offense happened. So the idea that, well, maybe low IQ people are more likely to get caught, or low IQ pedophiles are more likely to get caught, barring a time machine, there is no way that the ones who got caught went backwards and then failed a grade. There was something that happened on the way forward. We're starting to get links that something was different about these people early in life. Physically shorter, and I say that a bit self-consciously. The amount by which a pedophile is less short than people who committed offenses against sexual offenses against adults or people who committed no offenses at all is about 2.5 centimeters. That's double the difference you would get when a woman smokes while she's pregnant. There's no way that this kind of thing causes somebody to be there is no way that height is a result of arrest or a result of committing an offense. Height and a peak height is something that happens before the offenses do. So whatever, again, whatever was different in these people was different before the offenses. Handedness was probably the biggest clue. Handedness in humans develops in utero, while there's still a fetus in the mother's womb. In fact, on sonograms, fetuses will show a preference for which thumb they suck that you can see on the sonogram, and that thumb preference in adulthood becomes their handedness. Well, the only way, and here we have roughly 30% instead of, in the regular population, it's 8 to 10%, so it's triple that. The only other groups that have that elevated rate of non-right-handedness are people with, you know, well-acknowledged neurological disorders, schizophrenia, autism, and so on. Whatever it was that made these people different, the only way to explain this is that that difference had to have been there at this point before birth. I can't tell you what the chain of events is, but the only way to explain this is whatever the chain of events is, the first links of that chain had to be before birth. There's no other way to explain it. So on the basis of, you know, this pile of research then started getting us the justification to start doing this directly. Can we see a difference in the brains of pedophiles versus non-pedophiles in terms of the actual brain anatomy directly? The short answer is yes. There have been a series of studies. We're still disagreeing over exactly where in the brain, but we have each been able to find specific differences in the anatomy of the brain when you compare a pedophile versus non-pedophile. This one was from my group. Okay, now everybody, as you can see, this is the superior occipital frontal fasciculus of the left hemisphere and arcuate fasciculus of the right hemisphere. Say it again with me. To me, when we saw it on brain scans, it kind of looked like Marge Simpson holding a frying pan. Okay, but ultimately what it meant, and we found differences in an unexpected place, we found differences actually in the connective tissue of the brain, which I never expected. But it turns out that the areas of the brain that are connected by those by this white matter stuff are the areas of the brain that individually respond to sexual stimulus. The visual centers, no surprise. The motor control areas as the person is imagining going through the motions, again, no surprise. Sensory integration, and one part where people suppress their own behavior because everything's only happening in their imagination. So given the evidence that it's in the brain brings us to the big questions. As you know, the neurofolk try to figure out exactly where in the brain is it, it's hard to explain this without it. Some people still ask, is it in the genes? Probably not. There's no evidence, there's no direct good evidence that it is in the genes. People who are pedophilic are much less likely to reproduce. You'd think that it would have died out through evolution already, but it hasn't. which seems to argue that it's not genetic, perhaps some interaction, maternal stress during the pregnancy, if the mother or the family environment, you know, were poorly nourished or something else. Perhaps it's something that we can control and prevent even before the fetus is born. So can they, are they born with it? I'm not sure that they're born with it. It's possible that they're born merely with a risk. But if we can figure out which of these infants, pregnancies, young people are at risk for developing pedophilia to begin with, well, we know that we can't turn a pedophile into a non-pedophile in adulthood, but if we can find that early link, if we can find where the whole thing starts, then not only are we, will we be in the position to prevent the second offense, which is the reason we have the justice system, but if we can figure out what that first link is, then we can prevent the first offense. Now, this is usually what I hear from the public when we talk about, you know, can we change the brain or a pregnancy to result in turning a pedophile into a non-pedophile? Those of you who are of a certain age might remember this as Clockwork Orange. But really, my fears are the reverse. The Frankenstein villagers, once you have the idea, even though we all very easily will sign on to the idea of eliminating pedophilia, what kind of social and biological control over other human beings are we talking about doing, and are we willing to do that? Now all of a sudden, we have two very, very important principles fighting each other. So, these are the various groups that I hear from, and unfortunately, each one has a piece of the actual truth. Each one of them has the right to their own views and their own emotions, but that it has become such a yelling match in so many different areas that no one of them actually is taking a whole perspective and figuring out what will solve the entire problem as opposed to addressing their individual experiences. Although I appreciate their individual experiences, often the thing that most benefits one group is at the cost of another group, and we need to take a much more holistic approach. So instead of what we're doing now, which is looking at the situation in a very black and white way, we need to start looking at it really in a system of grays. We're not always going to be sure who the offender is, and we're not only the potential offender is, we're only going to be able to come up with a percentage. But really, my hope is that where we can go with MRI-based research is to continue with the protections of the public. We can't force anybody into treatment, and we need to maintain their confidentiality. But by the same token, as I say, if we can figure out whatever general factor it is that puts a person at risk for developing pedophilia, then instead of preventing, as I say, the second offense, we can prevent the first one. And I always like to close with this quote from Magnus Hirschfeld, one of my heroes. My greatest hope really is that we can establish justice through science. Thank you very much.
Thank you, James, and thank you, David. As before, I'm very happy to have questions. So if any of the tables have questions, we can pick them up. Hold on.
Oops, that's what I was afraid of. Because you want both hands.
What if the government spent funding on rehab and treatment of sex offenders as opposed to prison?
Question. The amount of money that goes into incarcerating somebody, depending on the state, is in some places $100,000 per person per year, and in some states with specialized programs, $200,000 per person per year. The amount of money that I spent in the research grant to conduct all of these things would be paid for by the amount of money of having one person in jail. If this ultimately leads to a way to prevent it, if I prevent one victim and prevent one person from committing an act, all of this research would have paid for itself. But as I say, where are the Americans? This clearly is not a matter of not being willing to spend the money. It's an unwillingness to spend the money intelligently. All of the money goes into cleaning up the mess instead of preventing the mess. But the cost effectiveness of the prevention and figuring out the original problem is, talk about chump change, a small, small fraction of the enormous amount of money that goes into the correctional system. I want to say correctional system.
to you.
Every time you read a scientific journal, you see somewhere in the limitations section, it says more research is needed. There's a couple of places where research really isn't needed anymore. The jury's back in that punishing people at great expense doesn't reduce their risk. If we want to punish people, then society should punish people. But if we actually want them to change and not get worse, we need to do something else. I didn't quite catch the entirety of the original question. I don't care where the money for rehabilitation comes from, as long as it comes from someplace. But obviously, punishment is not really helping us very much. Treatment can work. There's certainly controversy around the active ingredients in it, and it seems to work a little bit better if you have good treatment providers teamed up with good supervising agents. This is where we should be putting our efforts, and this is what's really newsworthy and doesn't get reported.
And we have time for one more if any other table has a question that they'd like me to read out. How do we best bring together the sometimes competing views and agendas of survivors, treatment providers, law enforcement, and politicians, etc.?
A long, long time ago, a woman named Faye Honeynop went into the Vermont prisons and said, if we're ever really going to understand how to beat the problem of sexual violence, we need to understand the person who's doing the violence. And in my career, I don't know how many times I've heard people say, you don't understand, my dad's a good guy. You don't understand, I really miss my brother. This stuff is really complicated.
I only have a very abstract answer, I guess. One is, regardless of how we come into each of these situations, it is tough to think about pedophilia or any sexual violence without an emotion. We're humans, that's what we do. But we have more than one set of emotions. We have what happened to me, what do I change, how do I deal with it, how do I live my life, how do I integrate this into my understanding of myself. And we also have all of society, what is best for all of us, and in the abstract, even though I might want this person killed, well, I'm also not a death penalty kind of a person, and I'm of mixed minds of this. So depending on how a person became interested in the topic, those are the parts that are very, very personal to each of us. But to work on a social level, it's often more helpful to, okay, I have my baggage, but now we need to think, once we get past each of our own baggage, the rest is what we have in common, which will prevent somebody like me from needing to be here, whether that's somebody coming in with a scientific interest or some personal experience of having gone through the system one way or another. But I think the one of the hardest things to watch, I'm a dual citizen American Canadian, one of the hardest things one of the hardest things it's been for me to watch now in Canada was to watch American culture become so angry and so punitive that I want to rename the Department of Justice the Department of Vengeance. Instead of justice, instead of fixing the problem, it's about how do I get the system to express my anger? I understand my anger, but my anger isn't going to fix the problem. It's not going to unmake a victim. Now and then we need to take a deep breath and work together on the areas of which are common interest. So even though we may have come in with different interests, it's the stuff that we can do together that I think will ultimately solve our mutual interest and problem.
And just because I'm jet-lagged and forgot a big piece of what I want to say is this is precisely why ATSA exists. That when I came into the field, people would say things like, I don't know how you can work with those people. And increasingly, I hear from victims' advocates, we really need to join up. We need to join forces. ATSA has managed to form all kinds of interesting collaborations with NSVRC and NCMEC and all manners of other organizations. The simple fact of the matter is we're at our best when we pick up the phone and talk to each other. And I'm really, really pleased to be living in a time when we're actually doing that. When
when we didn't do that 20, 25 years ago. So I guess the best answer to the question is join ATSA and all the other organizations too and get involved.
Next two speakers, Sandra Henriquez and Tom Tobin.